So this is a demo of Einstein's equivalence principle. The equivalence principle basically is that if you, maybe I should stand here. The equivalence principle is if, assuming that a gravitational field is uniform on the size of, say, this room, and uniform in time on the scale of an experiment, then if this room were in free fall, say it was a spaceship just out of gas and just following whatever the gravitational field was, and if we did sensitive experiments inside the room, we wouldn't be able to tell that there was a that we were falling in a gravitational field. All the rules of physics as appropriate for a rest frame and special relativity, all the experiments would be consistent with that. Okay. So in other words, in free fall, there's no gravity. There's no textbook. So now there's a spring in here that's not strong enough to pull this ball, which weighs about a third of a pound, back inside the cup because of the Earth's gravitational field. And so, on the other hand, what we know is that in free fall there's no gravity, and so the spring has a chance of pulling it in. And you see it actually did. This demo is based on, or the original idea for the demo comes from, was invented, the original demo was actually invented by a friend of Einstein's, who made the demo and gave it to him on his, I think, last birthday, or penultimate birthday. And he liked it very much. I got it from Anthony Z's book, Einstein Gravity in a Nutshell. And they made one over in UC Santa Barbara. And Anthony Gravagna, our head machinist, made this one. If you ever teach or do demos in elementary physics or in advanced physics, obviously, this would be a good demo to do. And if you go off and teach at some, other school, you can make this demo. It's not an not an expensive demo to make. The Exploratorium in San Francisco has an El Cheapo version of this demo, which you can actually make at home with rubber bands, staples, a cup, and so forth. I forget what it is, but if you go to the Exploratorium and Google and click appropriately, you'll see what they have. All right, we were talking, I was about to try to do Kolmogorov's test last time, I think this as an absolutely amazing result, and I think it's of real use in physics because it allows you to tell whether the results of experiments are consistent with a hypothesis as to what the actual physical laws are. And let me start from scratch on this. So basically, imagine that you have n different results from a test, and different measurements of some variable. And we can then make an empirical probability distribution. And this empirical probability distribution is simply 1 over n times the sum j equals 1 to n of delta x minus xj. Now that's the kind of that's an empirical probability distribution. Notice that it's normalized to unity. So what I want to do now is take these measurements and organize them in an order of increasing order. I want to say that xj is less than xj plus 1. We can just renumber them, because their order in time doesn't matter if we're not doing, we're not testing something having to do with time. And we very rarely test things having to do with time, actually. Dirac, by the way, thought that, I don't know if he thought it, but he thought it was worth thinking, or worth considering the possibility that the gravitational, that Newton's constant was so small because it had been decreasing in the last 14 billion years. When Dirac says something, you know, decades could pass and that might prove him right. So now, this is the kind of probability distribution we talk about as physicists. Probability of it being X. Mathematicians talk about something else that's closely related, and it's the integral. So it's the probability distribution. And I added an R. And it's the probability that a measurement would occur between a measurement would occur between minus infinity and x. And so this would be the integral from minus infinity to x of the empirical probability distribution at x prime dx prime. And that, of course, is the integral from minus infinity to x of 1 over n sum delta x minus xj, sum on j, dx prime, and there's a prime on that x. And so what is that? That will, you know, delta functions are easy to integrate. That just gives you a 1 for every xj that occurs lower than this. And so this thing is equal to j over n if x is less than xj plus 1 and greater than xj. And that x is supposed to be about a half inch higher. So this is called the cumulative probability distribution, and this is the probability distribution that mathematicians talk about. It's it has the advantage that if you take something like this, it regularizes it. And in fact, this empirical distribution then is a staircase function. It looks like this. 0 if you're way, way back there, and then it goes up, and then up, and looks like that. Okay. Now, so you can do a lot of measurements. You can create a staircase function, which is an empirical, that's the E, probability distribution within measurements. You do that. Now the question is, how do you tell whether this empirical cumulative probability distribution comes from a a certain theory. Now the theory will allow you to calculate a probability distribution like this, and therefore an empirical probability distribution, a theoretical cumulative probability distribution. By the way, are we getting the top of the blackboard?
Yes.
Okay, because it's not important to get my feet in the picture, it's important to get the whole blackboard. Okay, so that's the big question. And Kolmogorov defined a distance. And it's called the supremum, or the least upper bound, over all x of the absolute value of the empirical cumulative probability distribution on minus infinity up to x minus the cumulative probability distribution that's theoretical on minus infinity x, that absolute value. So SUP is also least upper bound or whatever. So in other words, here you use theory to generate a large number of points, and then you integrate over them and you get a theoretical probability distribution. And you can take, since you're doing this theoretically, you can just take the number of, you can just use a computer to make the n goes to infinity limit of that. But here, each point is an experiment, so n is a finite number there. And, well, it's kind of obvious that since these cumulative probabilities are bounded by 1 and 0, in fact, that's one of the nice things about this notion of probability, is that it's the mathematician's probability is a function that's always between 0 and 1. And consequently, this thing is between 0 and 1. So we have 0 less than or equal to Kolmogorov distance less than or equal to 1. Okay. In the notes, I talked about Smirnov distances, but I think they're irrelevant, and I'm relegating those to the problems for the second edition, if that ever happens. So here's the issue. You expect that if you've got the right theory, then this Kolmogorov distance should go to zero as n goes to infinity. And so you can define the limit as n goes to infinity of d sub n, and of course you write that as d infinity. And if the empirical distribution is the same, is correct, in other words, if it's coming from, or I'm sorry, if the theory is right, that is, that the theory is correctly describing the physics, then the empirical distribution should tend toward the theoretical distribution as n goes to infinity, and so dn should approach zero, or d infinity should be zero, is what I should say. So the question is this zero? If it's zero, then maybe the empirical distribution is the theoretical distribution. In fact, it probably is if it's back approach zero. But there's a theorem by somebody named Glubenko that, in fact, if you have the right theoretical distribution, then d infinity is zero. Okay. But that's not particularly surprising. You'd expect that to be the case. The real issue is how fast is what happens to d sub n as n goes to infinity. And the Russian scientists and engineers were almost always working with shortages of funds. So they were always cutting corners. And one of the things that Kolmogorov's work allowed them to do was to figure out whether the theory was right doing a minimum number of experiments. Okay. And what he proved was a theorem that I find absolutely amazing. And here's what he showed. And this was something that he showed in 1933. Okay. Now, one assumption is that the theoretical distribution should be continuous. Well, I mean, it's hard to imagine that it wouldn't be. I mean, even if we start out with a porcupine empirical distribution, when we make it cumulative, it's, is it continuous? Yeah, I guess it's not, continuous means you can't have jumps in being continuous, right? Okay, so the staircase thing is not continuous, but on the other hand, that's the empirical distribution. You expect that the theoretical distribution really is continuous. Okay, so if the theoretical distribution is continuous, then the limit as n goes to infinity of the probability of square root of n times d sub n, the probability that that's less than u, so u is some positive real number, that probability is equal to something, and it's equal to the Kolmogorov function, k of u, which in turn is equal to 1 plus twice the sum from k equals 1 to infinity of minus 1 to the k e to the minus 2 k squared u squared. Okay, now what's truly amazing here is that this probability that root n times the Kolmogorov distance is less than u is actually equal to k of u universally, no matter what the theoretical and empirical probability distributions are. Okay. So it's an incredibly general result. How it can be true, I don't know, but it is. So I'm not going to try to give the derivation of this here. I think it's absolutely an amazing result. Now, what is this k of u? Well, if you plot k of u looks like this. Here's u. And if you go between 0 and 2, k of u, k of u, of course, is a probability. So it is between 0 and 1. Well, it turns out that it looks like this. And somewhere around 1, it rises steeply. And as u approaches 2, it essentially approaches 1. Okay. So now let's just look at this Kolmogorov theorem from a distance. What it is saying is that if your measurements are coming from the theoretical distribution, then the limit of the distance between your empirical and the theoretical should be should satisfy this rule. Now this thing is no bigger than 2. N is going to infinity, square root of N is going to infinity. So this is essentially saying that the distance between the empirical and theoretical cumulative probability distributions should go to 0 as 1 over root N. And so one can, and so that's a way of telling whether your theory is right or not. If your theory satisfies this, you're okay. If it doesn't, you're not. And now when Kolmogorov did this, this was back in the 30s, I don't think there were any real computers available. And so what he was doing was really speculative and theoretical. Whereas these days, we've got fast computers and cheap fast computers, which is even better.
Called cell phones.
What?
Called cell phones. Cheap fast computers are called cell phones or smartphones.
Yeah, yeah, that's true too, yeah. And so we can play around with this. And so I did some illustrations to test this. And in particular, what I did was I picked two distributions. Of course, one was Gauss's distribution, and another was Gossett's, which is Gossett, remember, published under the name Student, because his employer, Guinness, wouldn't let him publish. And so what I did was I picked the Gaussian distribution, PG of X, 0, 1, and the Student distribution, PS of X, 3, 1. These have the same mean, and both have zero mean and unit variance. And so this is 0. And so the question was then, how does Kolmogorov's test work to tell? In other words, if the true distribution is Gaussian, and we instead generate the points, the empirical points from Gossett or Student's distribution, which have the same mean and variance, will Kolmogorov's test tell us that we've got the wrong theoretical distribution? It's not the Gaussian. Yeah.
So, but if we're taking n to infinity, aren't they the same anyway?
Well, wait.
Aren't the probability distributions the same as n goes to infinity?
I mean, great question, but there's no n in either of these probability distributions.
But I mean, for like the. Like to tell if like the theoretical probability is close to your empirical.
No, the cumulative distributions will be different.
Okay.
And the distance between the two is Kolmogorov's distance, and what Kolmogorov says is if they were coming from the same distribution, in other words, if you use, say, Gaussian's distribution to make two independent sets of a gazillion points and did these two things, then the distance between them would go to 0 as 1 over root n. If they came from the same distribution,
oh, okay.
If they come from different distributions, then the distance between them doesn't do that. And in fact, what I found was that it in fact rises basically as rises as this d goes to a d infinity, not 0. So it rises as square root of n.
Okay.
Okay, now the reason I chose the Gaussian distribution is that we can write down immediately what the theoretical cumulative probability distribution is. And it's just equal to 1/2 Earth of x over root 2 plus 1. So that is the Gaussian cumulative probability distribution. In other words, this is the integral minus infinity to x of pg x 0, 1, dx prime from minus infinity to x. That is the error function. I put a new version of 13 on the web page this afternoon. Then I made some more changes, so I have to put another one up. But in any event, if you look on the section on the error function, tells you, relates the cumulative probability distribution for Gaussian to the error function. Let's see, did I give you the candy yet?
No.
Okay. All right, any questions?
So this SUP that you put up there, this
I'm sorry, say it again?
Call it the Suprema or whatever it is?
Yeah, least upper bound if you want.
Yeah, so it's just like the biggest number in the set. Right?
Yeah.
That's what I'm
okay. Yeah, I don't know. When I was in college, it was the least upper bound.
Yeah, it might not actually be part of the set of numbers, because if you have a function that converges toward a maximum, it might not actually reach that maximum.
It
might not actually reach that maximum.
Right.
So
right. But it's not least upper bound.
Right. But it's not.
Oh, that's a better term than supremum, is what you're saying.
Not. I think he said it was of this the number of the set of numbers that you're looking at, but it doesn't have to be.
Right.
Of the,
No. You're right. Yeah. All right. In fact, I think least upper bound is a better term than supremum, because supremum suggests that it is the highest number of the set of points, which would be for a finite set of points. And in fact, we're talking about a finite set of points on a sense. Well, maybe not, because that's an even amount. All right, I don't know. Let's not get philosophical about it. Okay, so what I did then was I generated on a computer. You know, we change color just for variety. I set n equal 10 to the m. And I set m equal to 1, 2, up to 6 points. And I took these points from the theoretical distribution, Pt of x was, as I said, just the Gaussian of x 0, 1. Okay. And then I computed u sub n, which I defined as square root of n being 10 to the m, times d 10 to the m, and basically there are 10 to the m points drawn from the Gaussian, made a cumulative probability distribution, so this gave me a PR empirical n points, and m was 10 to the m of x. And then I also made the theoretical one 10 to the m of x, and that's, well, actually I don't even need 10 to the m. I just the cumulative theoretical one is just 1/2 Earth of X plus a half. Okay, so here's what I found, and it was square root of 10 to the m, d sub 10 to the m. Now this is the distance between the theoretical and empirical staircase functions, if you will. And although this is a continuous function rather than a staircase function. Anyway, here's what I got. 0.7074. So this is m equals 1, in other words, 10 points, 100 points, 1.2, 0.7356. And 1.0683. So these are, this is a million points, 10 to the 6th, n equals 10 to the 6th. So you notice two things, namely that square root of n d is always less than 2. And so the probability that it's less than 2 is indeed 1, or at least this is consistent with the probability of it being less than 2 equal to 1. And these distances multiplied by this, so d for m equals 6, d a million is multiplied by 1,000. That's because the theoretical and empirical are the same. On the other hand, I did the same thing with keeping the theoretical one, the Gaussian, and using as the empirical one the student distribution. Then I computed these numbers, and then square root of 10 to the m, d 10 to the m, was 0.7741. So you see, for just 10 points, you can't tell. It's as n gets big that you learn. 1.4522, well, you still can't tell. That's 100 points. But you get to 1,000 points, and it's 3.3837. You get to 10,000 points, it's 9.0478. 100,000 points, 27.6414, and a million points, 87.8147. So only the first two are less than 2. And so what you learn here then is that students' distribution is not Gaussian distribution. But notice how this fits with, you know, if you're trying to do something on a limited time scale, limited budget, or something that's expensive, being able to distinguish two theories with a minimal number of experiments is important. Here you'd need 1,000 experiments. Or actually, this, you probably went above, you might only have needed a few hundred experiments, 400 say, and you would have gone above 2. By the way, you're able to compute the exact value of d infinity for the distance between Gossett and Gauss, and the answer is that d infinity is equal to 0.08685523.56 plus terms of higher order. All right, I actually went one step further in this, but this one step further is kind of confusing, and I'll just sort of show you the result. You can compute, let's see, what did I do? Each time I read this, I find it sort of confusing, but basically, I generated a lot of sets. L equals 1/400 sets of n points, n equal 10 to the n points, xj, xjl. So these are 10 to the m points, L sets of them, in fact 100 sets. From the Gaussian and from students. And I use them to form 100 cumulative probability distributions and empirical, this one from students. So there are now LM of these. So there are 100 different ones, and each one is drawn from 10 to the n sets of points. So then I computed the distances of all these guys from Gaussian and all these guys from Gaussian. And so I got a bunch of distances, Kolmogorov distances. Okay, so here's the situation. I've got here probability of as a function of U, and U the distances. These are the Kolmogorov distances, and then the probability of U. Alright, so what is it? Well, here this goes to 4, this is 2, here's K of U, this is Kolmogorov's function. Now, if it's Gaussian-Gaussian empirical, those distances basically did this. They tracked this. On the other hand, student Gaussian did this. And this was for 10 to the 2 points. For 10 to the 3 points, it was something that looked like that. And for 10 to the 4th points, it couldn't fit on the graph, so I just crossed it out. Okay, I think that's enough about Kolmogorov. It's pretty amazing. I just actually can't even imagine how it can be that this thing is so universal. I mean, it doesn't matter what the two distributions are. Just amazing. All right, now let's go to something that's vastly simpler in a sense. The Monte Carlo methods. Now these are really, really useful. And they're useful now. They weren't useful when Kolmogorov was writing because there weren't any computers. But this method, by the way, was actually, Roy Glauber told me that this was invented by Fermi at when he was either in Chicago or Bolzano during the war, or maybe actually when he was in Italy just analyzing his own experiments. He didn't think this was very important because he had done things that were more important. And because it was just an empirical thing, and also computers hadn't yet come into existence. So it was kind of it wasn't terribly practical. Anyway, he showed it to Metropolis. Metropolis wrote it up And then Metropolis and his wife, and Teller and his wife, all wrote a joint paper with four authors in which they described the thing in sufficient detail that people could learn about it. They weren't allowed to publish, though, during the war, so they put this out, some journal of chemistry, in sometime after the war. Anyway, let's just look at a really simple example of the Monte Carlo method, and this is for numerical integration. So suppose you want to integrate some function, f of x, function of several variables, dnx, over some region. Okay. So what you say is, all right, it is, you generate a bunch of random points. Let's say that this thing R is inside a certain well, if the volume of the region is V, okay, so then you generate a bunch of points randomly, and then you call n sub r the number of points. The number of points that fall within the region. So you're generating these x's randomly, and let us say uniformly over a certain hypercube. Here's my poor man's hypercube, three-dimensional hypercube. And inside the hypercube is some funny region, R. And so you keep track of how many of the points fell within the region. You take the average, NR is the number of points fell within the region. This is the average value. And then you multiply by the volume of the region. And that gives you an approximation to this. And this is an approximation that works, that falls off as 1 over square root of n. And that square root of n is in some sense related to the square root of n of Kolmogorov, in some sense. Now, it may be, if this region is kind of a funny looking region, you may have trouble defining it or keeping track of, you may have trouble even computing the volume of the region. And so what you can do is you can say, well, the volume of the region is the number of points, the number of points that fall within it divided by the total number of points that you throw times the volume of the hypercube. Which might be, I mean, if it's a, it might not be a perfect cube, so it might be L1, L2, up to Ln. And so then you say the integral over R, f of x, dnx is approximately Ln, again, for the cube, called hypercube, Ln over n, k equals 1, nr, f of x, k. So you still have to keep track of whether your random points fall within the funny region that you're talking about. So that's the answer. So in the class notes, I gave an example, f of x and y, e to the minus 2x minus 3y over square root of x squared plus y squared plus 1. The utility of this method is that it works equally well no matter how complicated this thing is. You know, it's just make it twice as complicated, you just add another line of Fortran or C or whatever you're using. And indeed, I ran this thing for this particular case. I ran it for 10 to the L points. L equals 1 up to 8. And I got point, I'll round these off, 0.059, 0.113, 0.119, 0.115, 0.118, 0.1178, 0.1178, maybe I'll put 6268, 0.117898. Okay. So that's what I, those are the numbers that I got. And you can see they obviously converge. All right, so this is one way of, this is one application of random numbers. And of the Monte Carlo method. This is the very simplest Monte Carlo. One step up from this is to use quasi-random numbers. So up over here, we're generating pseudo-random numbers from a random number generator that comes as part of your software. Quasi-random numbers are more sophisticated. Quasi-random numbers. These are numbers that occur with equal density in every region. And an example, these are, one example is a Halcon sequence. And others were invented by Sobol, whose name ends with a quote, and I have no idea what that means. I did study Russian for a year in college, but I have no idea what that means. Anyway, let me just show you some of these Halcon sequences. A half, a quarter, three quarters, one eighth, five eighths, 7/8, 1/16, 9/16, and so forth. That's a base 2 Halcon sequence. Another is a third, 2/3, 1/9, 4/9, 7/9, 2/9, 5/9, and so forth. Now, when you first look at this, you'd say, I don't want to use that because there's nothing random about this. This is terribly predictable. Well, maybe so, but in fact,
you're covering an area in a systematic way.
Yes, you're right, it is better. And I remember I first learned about these sequences, but didn't learn how good they were. I just, you know, was given a random number generator that generated these. And I was at a colloquium at Harvard, and I was just talking to somebody about these. And sitting there was the Nobel laureate, guy who invented, he's invented so many things. He invented the 21 centimeter radio telescopy. He invented, Edward Purcell. And he invented the NMR technique. Now some of these things he did with other people. And he just heard a few words out of my mouth and said, but those are better. And I looked at him, and of course I should have said, why? And he would have told me probably in three words, but I was too shy and I didn't say anything. I said, thank you. Anyway, in my old age, I've learned that these four, sequences, whereas this sequence approaches the correct answer as 1 over root n, square root of capital N, these go down as, the error goes down as 1 over the square, 1 over the 2/3 power of n, which is what you were saying, they're better. And there are codes that generate these sequences, and you can find them in various places. All right. So the next topic is how you suppose you go into experimental physics and you want to use the Monte Carlo technique. Well, the usefulness of it here is you want to be able to tell If you get some bizarre result, well, what do you do with it? Is this a result that is just a statistical fluctuation, or is it something you need to worry about? And or something you need to not worry about, but become excited about. Because you could, in other words, if you're manning a detector and you're counting, say, neutrinos, or pi zeros or something or other in a detector, and all of a sudden you get a bigger flux, well, if this was back in 1987, it might have been the flux from the supernova that hit the Earth finally in 1987, and in fact was observed in a big detector that was looking for proton decay, which has never been seen, by the way. Is it that, or is it, or is, you know, it could have been that somebody screwed up and put twice as much power through your photodetectors, and that's what caused this signal. But what you can tell from using the Monte Carlo method is whether this is a random fluctuation, is plausibly a random fluctuation, or whether it's something you should look into, either as being a discovery or something wrong with the equipment. That's basically the idea. All right, so the example is one I got from somebody who used to be a postdoc here, Bernie Becker, who, very bright guy. I don't know if any of you ever met him, but I loved talking with him because he was always reading widely. And would read some book that was of interest and then would tell me about it when I bumped into him in the hall. Anyway, when he was a graduate student, he was counting muons. And this was in an underground detector. And I imagine that his experiment was part of a neutrino experiment, a neutrino oscillation experiment. So it was a big detector underground. But the background, some of the background was muons caused by neutrinos. And so basically a cosmic ray would hit a nucleus, make a shower of pions. Pions would decay into muons. The muons would decay into neutrinos and electrons. The neutrino could hit an electron in the detector and make a muon. And so these were things that he was seeing, and it was background, I think, for him. And basically, the rate of muons was about 0.1 muons per day. And so you could model this as a Poisson distribution. In other words, the probability of n muons on a given day was this. So it was 0.1 to the n over n factorial e to the minus 0.1. And so that's basically what he was seeing day after day there. Now, he would then, I think as part of his work, he generated, oh, he did something like this. This is what I did. But he probably did something similar, or somebody else in the group did. Anyway, what I did was I generated a million histories of 100 days. So this is about 300,000 years of watching. And these, and on each day, I computed the number of muons that were observed in the detector by using this Poisson distribution. Okay. And so then I plotted it. And if you plot log 10, number of histories, and here number n of muons, what did it look like? Well, in one day, it looked like this. A certain probability for zeros, zero muons, much higher. And this was about 6, this was 0, for 1 muon, 2 muons was something like that, 3 muons was like that, 4 muons was like this, and higher, you couldn't even see it. That's in one day. So in other words, to say it exactly right, the maximum number of muons detected on a single day was 1, 2, 3 on 62, 36, and 1.5% of the runs, and was 0, 4, 5, 6 on only 36, 4, 10, 9, and 1 run out of, course, a million runs, a million histories. I should have said history rather than run. Now you can ask, what was the maximum number of muons detected in the whole history? Well, this went somewhat like this. And this is 30 over here. The most likely number was something like 10. And 10 maximum number of muons on a single day in 100 days. So about 125,000 histories had 10 muons on a single day. Not any particular day, but one of the 100 days. All right. So that indicates that how you can then, if you see something in, if you're doing these, you're counting your muons, you then could compare your one history with this table here. And you could say, well, does it look reasonable? And in fact, what you could do, now that I think about it, is you could say, here's my history. You could do a Kolmogorov test with this distribution, which would be the theoretical distribution, okay, and however, you know, taking n to infinity, you can't quite do. But because if you use Kolmogorov, then you know, the graduate student doesn't have to sit. Bernie doesn't have to have sat there for the rest of his life. He can actually quit at some point and see whether the n, square root of n, d sub n, rises above 2 or not. All right, I did not try to do that with this, but that is, that's something that I probably should do if I ever go to prison and have a lot of time. okay. So these are two of the important uses of the Monte Carlo method. I'm now going to switch and tell you something totally different, which is another use, and which is a use in theoretical work that's really quite important. This usage was, in modern times, it was first used, I think, by chemists who, I guess, were trying to figure out what the shape of some molecules might be. Well, I need to erase the board, and while it's drying, then I'll use the whiteboard. Next week, we have a visitor, an important visitor, Michael Kreutz. Michael Kreutz basically brought the Monte Carlo method into theoretical particle physics. The only people using it at the time he brought it into theoretical particle physics were people doing numerical chemistry. At this point in theoretical particle physics, Kenneth Wilson at Cornell had introduced something he called lattice-gauge theory, but he had no idea of how to do any calculations. And because he didn't know about the Monte Carlo method, and also he didn't know about the Monte Carlo method. And Kreutz then wrote a couple of papers, many papers, showing people how to do that. In fact, one of Kreutz's papers, which I looked at, was published in PhysRev, and he published the Fortran code. And in fact, it was probably Fortran 77 because the paper was back in the early 80s. All right. So let me explain how this works. The most common use of it, well, I have to use this for the moment. So the most common use of this is to generate a Boltzmann distribution of But you can generate, as I will get to, either today or, today is what, Thursday? Or Tuesday. Oh, I was telling you about Kreutz. Kreutz is coming on, I guess, Wednesday night. He's going to give a seminar at 4 o'clock on Thursday, and then a colloquium at 4 o'clock on Friday. You should go to both colloquia. I mean, both talks. Now, I was going to suggest that instead of having class at 5:30 on Thursday of next week, we just have Kreutz's seminar at 4. On the other hand, there are some people who can't go to the Kreutz seminar at 4 because they have group meeting or this or that. So we'll have both. I will talk at 5:30, and Kreutz will talk at 4. Kreutz is, as I said, he's really a major figure in modern theoretical physics. And he wrote a very nice book, at least one, on lattice-gauge theory. And he has a website that's a delight. And I refer to it in these notes and on the page. Okay, so the basic thing is, suppose you want to know what the minimum energy, what the minimum configuration, the minimum geometry is of a particular protein. Suppose the protein has 200 amino acids. That's, say, 4,000 atoms. And so your vector would have 12,000 components because each atom has three XYZ, three coordinates. So you've got a system with 12,000. You want to find out in the space of 12,000 dimensions, where's the minimum? Right. So you can't just take a derivative set equal to zero and solve a quadratic equation. No.
Or follow the gradient.
What?
Or follow the gradient to find the minimum.
Yeah, well, you could, but you've got to do a lot of tracing. All right, anyway, so, And moreover, you may not even want the minimum. What you may want is to know what the value is of some observable if the system is at some finite temperature. That's the actual thing. And to tell you the truth, most people doing the molecular biology aren't doing that. They are instead doing something else, which is of less scientific interest, but is easier to do. And what they're doing is they're just finding the state that has minimum energy. What configuration has absolutely minimum energy? But that may not have minimum entropy, and so it may not be physically relevant. And but they don't care. And in fact, you ask, what is the experimental determination of the shape of the protein? Well, it's X-ray crystallography. So what do you do there? You grow the protein in a crystal of the protein. And you then, and of course the crystal is then effectively frozen. In fact, you may keep it at very low temperature. And then you hit it with a beam of X-rays from all angles, and you do X-ray crystallography to find out what the geometry is, and all you get are the nuclei of the heavier nuclei. You don't get the hydrogen. Okay, so much for that. So what is the trick? What you want to do is you want to... All right, suppose X is a configuration. And what you do is you generate, by the Monte Carlo method, a sequence of configurations. And after you've generated maybe a million configurations, you figure, okay, now you start measuring. And the idea is that, all right, let me show you exactly what the idea is. So you want to know, should you go from X to X prime? Well, if you're at X, your probability of transition is going to be 1 if the energy of X prime is less than the energy of X. On the other hand, you say, if you're at X prime, the probability of going to X, it's not 0, but it's e to the minus e of x minus e of x prime divided by kt. You take that to be the probability. So in other words, if... Oh, I screwed up. So now, if e of x prime... So here, in the first case, x prime is, I screwed up in, I'm not following notes, so obviously I'm screwing up. All right, let's see if this makes sense. So you want, so now, e of x prime is less than e of x. Oh, if e of x prime is less than e of x, probability is 1. If e of x prime is greater than x, okay, you've got to do this. So now, e x prime is greater, this is positive, e to the minus, small, and if e of x prime is much bigger than e of x, then the probability of going there, zippo. Okay? So you do this. Now, the important thing is that what you're doing is you're making random changes in your, say, 12,000 coordinates. And each change has to be unbiased. So you generate a random number, subtract a half, and you go forward or backward with equal probability. And the thing has to be ergodic, so you have to be able to get from any one point to any other point. And as long as you don't do anything stupid, then the thing works like a charm. You do the slightest subtle thing that's stupid, and it doesn't work at all. Now you ask, well, why is it that this works at all? Well, the reason it works is that when you finally get to equilibrium and the thing and the set of configurations aren't qualitatively changing, then that's when P of x to x prime is equal to P of x prime to x. And that is when, let's see, I should have written, I should have followed my notes, but let us say, all right, what are you looking at my notes? Okay, what is the rate of going from x prime to x minus the rate of going to x prime? What is this? Well, this is some rate of, that depends on the computer and how often you get to x or x prime. And then it's the probability the thermal probability of getting to x minus the thermal, so this is the, in other words, as you start out cold, and after you've done these moves for a long time, this thing is getting a little bit warm, and now this is a prime here, this is an x here, and this is e to the minus e prime minus e over kt. Okay, this is for the case e prime greater than e. Okay, so that's the rate of going from x prime to x. And now you can say, well, when do you stop making these transitions? You stop making the transitions when this thing is zero. And that means that the thermalization probability of x prime is equal to the thermalization probability of x times e to the minus e prime minus e over kt. And so that means then that p thermal of, let us say, x prime is e to the minus e of x prime, that's what I, over kt, times something which I'll call c, which doesn't depend upon x prime, namely pt of x, no x prime, e, no x prime, k and t, no x prime. This, of course, is what you want. This is the Gaussian distribution or the Boltzmann distribution. All right. I think because I screwed this up so much and because it's so simple, despite the fact that I screwed it up, I'm going to, on Tuesday, I'm going to just do this again, and this time I'm going to follow my notes rather than just wing it on the board. All right, so there's a colloquium on Friday, 5 o'clock. It's about big data in high-energy physics. There's a talk at 1:30 by the same person, somebody, Maria something from Caltech, and she, I guess, is going to be talking about LHC results at 1:30. And I urge you to go to both talks. And then next week, 4 o'clock here on Thursday, and 4 o'clock on Friday over there in Dainsmith Hall for Michael Kreutz, who's quite a good lecturer, even though he's at a national lab.
Will he be talking about materials similar to?
He'll be talking about lattice-gauge theory, which is the application of this Monte Carlo stuff to lattice-gauge theory, and the timing is great, because I'll talk about this again on Tuesday, and I'll actually finish this carefully without any help. Promise to follow my notes. Promise. Swear to God. Close my mouth. And so by Thursday you should be should know all about Monte Carlo and Lattice-gauge theory. Okay, so we might as well stop now.